Coming to the open session for the Director of Advising, which is a very important position. Hopefully you all have evaluation sheets, yes? Okay, and then when you're done, you're going to hand them into myself or Kelly before you leave, please. And we will have about 20 minutes for a presentation about the vision. This is Shalamar Lundy, our last candidate. And then we're going to open it up for questions and answers, and then I'll give her a few minutes at the end to say any last words which you want to leave you with. So I'm going to turn it on over to Shalamar.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for coming in to hear me talk about my shared vision for academic evaluating. And I definitely think it's shared because everyone who's a stakeholder in this college is a part of what my vision is. So I want to go ahead and get started with you guys. So first, for those who don't know me, I'm Shalamar Lundy. I'm currently the lead assistant director of academic advising. I work with the schools of public affairs and social services, as well as business, logistics, and supply chain. I've been in the advising office for 8 years. I started out in 2011 as a part-time advisor, and I was hired then under academic degree completion, which was focusing on students who were so close to graduating but had disappeared. So from that, I have made my way to an academic advisor full-time. Then in 2016 January, I became the lead assistant director for advising, and today I want to present to you myself as the director of academic advising. Okay?
Yeah.
So, the agenda for today that I have is, I just want to go over a review, is that, of course, I want to welcome everyone. Like I said, thank you for showing up, being here, because your presence matters, as well as the questions and feedback that I'll get. And then those who are viewing who couldn't be present for different reasons, thank you for listening and tuning in. Fill out those surveys. All right. So, what I'm going to talk about is a personal leadership philosophy. Then I want to go over three important highlights that are tied to my shared vision. One is campus culture, employee engagement, which focuses on retention. The second highlight is required advising / PIN numbers, which is going to focus on enrollment. And then lastly, the third highlight is school-based model, which is going to focus on completion. And then we'll have closing, and I'll leave it open for questions. All right? So, my leadership philosophy. So for those who are not for sure or know, there's so many different philosophies out there when it comes to education. But my leadership philosophy, something I'm very passionate about, and something that you all should think about creating for yourselves, is it's the way in which you lead from where you are without the title. It's where you are showing other people on the work that you do, the value you have in your work, but more importantly, the expectation and accountability that you have for yourself as well as others. So this is what my expectation in being selected to the director of academic advising would be, is that I expect authenticity. I want you to hold me to that accountability as well as I'll hold you to that. Servant. I'm a servant leader, so not only am I able to lead, sit at the table, and advocate, but I'm also able to get in the weeds when it's necessary. And in advising, it's always necessary. So, I'm there for that. Empathetic. It's not that I want to take sympathy on anyone in their story, but I do believe everyone has a story, and every story is important. So I empathize so that way I can have a better understanding of how to engage, but more importantly, how to get results, and the results that you need, not what I want. Transformational, that's something that we do every single day as we grow and go through our journey, is that we transform, and if you're not transforming, you just know the things around you are. So that's something that's important for me to help people be able to develop and transform with the environment in which they're in and where they're trying to go. And community-oriented. I have it as part of my tagline. I am teamwork makes the dream work. And that is something that from the time anyone has met me to right now and beyond, I will always stand for community. And community is about family, it's about the culture, and it's very important to me. And so that's what my philosophy is tied to. And as you can see, it all ends up with the students. this is the type of leader I am. I want for you as well to find your leadership philosophy because it's important and it means volumes of who you are and what you stand for. So, highlight one, campus culture and employee engagement. So I'm sure you guys are all like, why does she talk about that? So, I want you guys to know that the reason why I want to talk about it is because probably every single person in this room is an employee who is satisfied. And what that means is you're happy about your check, you're happy about these benefits, and most of them like each other. So, you are probably satisfied. But satisfied is not good enough for the type of work we do. The type of work we do requires employees to be engaged. And unfortunately, many of us are not engaged. And that's where I feel like my leadership can really assist in that. Because an engaged employee is someone that is volunteering to do things because they see the value in the work that they do. They want to see the mission accomplished. They want to see the goals being met. And they don't have a problem doing it without being asked, without begging, stealing, bartering. They just, because you're present, you want your presence known and your impact felt. So that's my goal at the beginning, to get the culture more engaged. So how we do that is access. So what I've learned is that as a lead, there's so many things that happen at the table that I really didn't know about, even though I was considered a leader in my department. And so having access to pertinent information that brings value to our work in advising is necessary to me. And so I'll talk a little bit more about that in the next slide, but having access is something that individuals who have invested in themselves deserve to have. So access is something that I feel like will help an employee engage in. Accountability. So accountability is something we all like to say, but a lot of us don't like to have on us. So I think that accountability can come with buddying up. So I work with, I work with a student organization, National Society for Leadership and Success. And their whole thing is success networks. Success networks is something we do for accountability. So if you have someone who knows your vision and knows your goal, they'll hold you accountable to that because that goal ties into what their goal is. And together you guys can meet your goals in a shared way. But at the same time, we don't always feel like being responsible. No matter how much responsibility you like to take on, it's not always something that you want to do. And that's where your accountability buddy or your success network can help you. So when it comes to knowing certain things around campus, if you have access to someone at Express Enrollment, if you have someone who has access in student success, if you have a faculty member that you have access, that you guys are networked together, then you guys have a way of sharing information, but also sharing the responsibility of meeting those goals and metrics that we all have. But many of us don't even know what those are, or we don't even know what each other's goals and metrics are. So it will help us work together and be more engaged when knowing that. Advocacy. This is something that I'm really firm in. I love to fight the right. Love it. But there's a way to go about it. And a lot of times that in the advising office, we don't always feel like there's someone advocating for us. So I think that engaging with employees is to have more advisors at the table having these conversations, especially with PIN numbers. So if an advisor can go to this meeting, regardless of what their title is or their position, the work they do is valuable, so it should be valued at the table. So having more conversations with advisors at the table would kind of help be able to speak to a story, a piece of a story that many don't know and don't understand unless you've actually done it. Advising is a skill set, if there's an art to it, and anyone who's volunteered to help us, you understand that. So I want to be at the table being an advocate, but more importantly, I want them to be able to be at the table to advocate for themselves and for our department. And through advocacy, audit communication. What that means is, a lot of times there's rumor mills, there's gossip, there's complaints, there's facts, there's fiction, there's all kinds of things that's going around Ivy Tech, and it doesn't help the story and it doesn't help the big picture. So I feel like if we get ahead as leaders to start to share the narrative so that way we control a lot of the negativity that flows, I think that would help us all feel more engaged and feel more empowered in the work that we do. So auditing the communication will help a lot with that. The next point, strength-based approach. I know that we all are strong in certain areas and some of us are stronger in areas than others. But that's where the success networks will come in. But more importantly, that's where you'll be able to know what your strength is. Ivy Tech didn't have you just put that on there because it looked cute next to the Ivy Tech logo. They want your five strengths because that lets other people know, like, these are the areas of which, if you need me, that I'm great in. That's how I look at it. And a lot of times, it just became a logo with no real intent behind it. But the impact is major when you have people work within their strengths. In the advising office just recently, over the last month, we have had so many people step up and do amazing things that are getting ready to be implemented, all because they were within their strengths and they had the freedom to do so. And we have some awesome things that are getting ready to come to us just about with that alone. And so it shows to me that working within our strengths not only will make employees feel more engaged, but also it will bring resources. Because we have some awesome resources that really might help with some of the concerns that we have with these metrics. And it all started with people being able to work within their strengths. So I feel like that's very important. Appreciative advising model. So this is a culture in which advisors would like to have, because we do a lot of hard work and I don't think enough people appreciate it, especially sometimes our students. So appreciative advising model is going to help support faculty, staff, advisors, and of course the major outcome is students. If we all feel good and we're all happy, the students will feel that same way. It's just like being a parent. If you are, your mood does impact your children. And that's the way it is when it comes to leadership. We have to take accountability. So I feel like that if we have an appreciative advising model in the office that we stand by and that we live by, then that's the respect that we hope our colleagues will accept. And then, of course, the students will fall right in line. And this is just a quote. High impact, I know you can read, but I'm going to read you. High impact practitioners realize that the positive outcomes of student interactions are not just limited to students. In fact, the real joy occurs when we understand how fulfilling it really is to impact other people's lives and how much we can learn from our students. And if you've ever taught or you've ever done a presentation, you realize that the thing that you get, that you're giving, is way less than what you're actually getting. And so I feel like the more that we appreciate the work we do as advisors, the others on campus will appreciate it, but more importantly, our students will. And that's what we need with these PIN numbers. Moving right along to required advising. So, you like the little grid, didn't you? So, this is what I have, two ideas that I've already had in place, and then two additional ideas that I think would be impactful for future. So, required advising is all about engagement. It can be a barrier, but we want to look at it as something different, and it's all about how we sell it. But if we don't know how important it is or what our plan of action is, then it just feels like we're just churning out numbers, giving out classes, and we're not doing really what the whole purpose of required advising is for. So my current initiative that I have to help grow is appointment availability. Now, I've spoken with a few advisors, especially when we're in the trenches, and we love having appointments. And for those who actually had a time when we were strictly walking in, it was chaotic. It was a lack of accountability as well, because those who work hard were working hard. And those who were just here were getting to be just here. And that caused a bad culture. So having appointments makes people still have accountability to the workload every day. But if we, right now with PIN numbers, we have no-shows, which you guys sometimes don't understand, that appointment can be booked out for a long time. And then when the time comes, anything could have happened and the student is no longer coming to the appointment, not available. And so that is an appointment that has been taken off the books that could have been utilized by someone who's present, ready to go, and ready to be served. So if we do some same-day appointments, now it doesn't have to be a culture of always, but with PIN numbers, it might have to be. But with that, we have a higher show rate, because if you're showing up now, then you probably want to be seen now. And yes, that means that some students won't be able to, the early bird gets the worm, but it's a train thing. Because when they go to work, if they have to be there at 8 o'clock, your boss is not going to say, well, come on in, whatever, and you get the work done. That's not how it works. And this is a train learning culture. So we have to understand that our students are willing to meet the bar wherever we set it. Because a lot of them are first generation. They have no idea what they are coming into. We're their navigators. So if we come in and say, this is how it is, then this is how it is. And that's okay. It doesn't change the access that you don't have to be a 4.0 Harvard student to get in here. That doesn't take away their access. But with access, there's still accountability, there's still requirements, there's still deadlines. And that is okay. So having the same day appointment is going to shift the culture, but we can train them and they will be fine. Pin parties is something that we do where that advising goes into the classrooms and meets the students where they are. So students will be able to be advised from their classrooms working with academic affairs. And it's something that we've done in the business department and public affairs, and there's great successes in that. Not only for the students, they're way more appreciative because they don't have to fit another appointment into their hectic lives. It's considering that everybody doesn't have the same access to us. And then it makes advisors happy and the faculty. There's so many teachable moments in that. And that will help to grow it. Future initiatives is maybe stagger pin distribution based on credit hours. There was talk at the table initially, but once things get going around here, they're gone. And so sitting at the table, maybe we can reel things back and have some different discussions about what happened to our initial plan. Because maybe we have to, the next pin cycle, maybe we need to do something different. It's not a one size fits all. One year, one thing might work, the next year it might not, and that's okay. If it's in our toolkit, it's still ours, and we'll be okay. And we have to be comfortable and flexible with that. And that will help with less traffic and advising to focus more to students. Future initiative, caseload metrics for advisors. Now, I came from proprietary education that I live by numbers, and I'm not a numbers girl. But numbers are helpful to measure things so we can manage the chaos. And we have a new advisor who has brought the light back into my life with numbers and how important and empowering it is. And I want to share that same empowerment with the other advisors. That know your job is not going to be like, you have to get out of here if you don't hit a metric. No, but you do want that for accountability. You want to feel like you have accomplished something. And if we have nothing to measure, then how do we know the work we're doing is beneficial? So going and having training for to understand how to run reporting over our own caseload so that we are more confident in the work that we do and understand how it fits the bottom line is something that I think will really help with the goal completion of 75% for academic plans. All right? We're moving along to my last highlight, which is school-based model. This ties everything into what I was just talking about with PINs. So, like I said, I'm going to lead over public affairs and business. And we've done this this is the second semester. And this semester, we have fine-tuned it a little bit better and got greater results. And I think that putting advisors in the schools makes so much sense on so many levels of training purposes, rapport building, retention, which retention is really attention. Because if people are getting the attention they need, then they will be retained. Just think in your own life, when people are paying attention to you, whether it's good or bad attention, you're focused and you're there, whether you should be there or not. It's no different with our students. So retention is really about attention. And when we're in the classroom, when we're over there with the faculty, we get their attention and respect in a different way, as well as our counterparts in the academic affairs office. So in January 2020, the public affairs and business advisor will be placed in the schools, working with my dean and program chairs, so that we can see if this is really something that if we scale it up, it will be something successful to the numbers that we're trying to meet. And I believe so because one week, myself and two other advisors, we worked some hours, but we'll work that out in the process. But we were so much happier. We didn't realize we worked that long because we were engaging. Our students were grateful. Our faculty, we caught things that would have never been caught if we were in the office. And it was an experience that I feel like every advisor deserves to have because it's valuable work. And what we do every day is valuable. So that we'll see how that looks once we get that started in January. So how this will help is it will assist academic affairs and academic advising collaboration efforts. So course building. So we'll know even better what courses to build. We won't waste time on building in significant classes to fill those with students who don't want to be in there. Or curriculum sequence. This is one of the things that we caught in the midst of being over there is that there was only online section offered and the program chair didn't know. But because we were with her, we were able to share with her, this particular class is not being offered face-to-face and every student needs this to continue on for completion and they're not happy with the learning style. She went in her office, waved a wand, I don't know, talked to Yoda, and it all came through. and the students were happy. So that's something that would have never happened if advisors were in the office. So this is something that we know for a fact is proven to work if we're together. Resource and communication support is training, is teachable moments the whole time. We learn so much. We got to be adjuncts that are usually not tied into our process with us. And they felt grateful because they felt a part of the story, because they're actually a major part of the story. And so us being present there allowed them to learn some things, asking questions, and it really helps them facilitate their classrooms. Registration efforts, this can also help as we partner with like express enrollment, admissions. This can help if we're over in the school because we can speak to certain things that they wouldn't necessarily know because they don't work with the academics in the same way. So this will help in that right as well. And then lastly, student engagement opportunities. There are students who have asked, can you be an advisor for this club, or telling us all exciting things about the clubs they're a part of, things that we wouldn't know had we not been in that setting with them, and as students we would have never spoke with, because their lives are so congested with here and there, balancing, that they would have never made it over into the office. They would have been ones emailing last minute, can I have my pen, or dropped in that week. But because we're in their classrooms, like, we got hugs and attitude of gratitude, and it was like, well, I'm glad I get this job, because it never felt that way before. So it helps with engagement opportunities, and it's necessary. All right, so I've spoken up, but I want you to take this away. And I will let you read this diagram in your head. I won't read to you this long. But please read it, or else I'm going to read it. And I need to make sure you're awake, so give me a little hand up when you're done reading, like we're at church. All right, go slow readers. You know what happens. Vision of four words. Make me feel important. Every single person in here has that feeling. Always. I have that feeling a few times a day, and I have to go to my people and be like, make me feel important, because I feel that. I do. And then once I feel important, I go pour into somebody else to make them feel important. That's the type of culture we have to create. This is a learning institution, and we're learning more than just what's in the book. As a matter of fact, most of us can learn a lot from our students because of surviving. Have nothing and still make it, how many of us actually can do that? We used to say, when you're on a desert island and you don't have this, what would you do? Well, some of our students, this is a deserted island. And what do? They survive. And when they get here, we cannot make them feel bad or ashamed for what they had to do to survive, because they're here and they could be anywhere else, but they're here with us. And so we have to know what we need to do to make them feel valued and important. But when you do that, you also are going to feel valued and important. And if not, somebody else in this room or in another department should feel good about themselves, important to you. And that's the culture in which we need to work in, because we're all satisfied with being here. Many of us don't really know what the next plan would be if we went somewhere else. So let's make this a place that we want to stay, grow, and continue to show our students that education, if nothing else saves you, education will. And now I am open for questions and your time to speak. Role, I'll have to learn to let go and delegate so much more, which some people on my team have told me to do, and I'm like, no, you're fine, not wanting to overload them. But that is a sign of a great leader, and that's something I'm learning, is that it's okay to delegate, because with delegation, you're giving someone else the opportunity to be a leader. And that's what I do. I love to build other people up. And if I take that away from them, then it's a disservice. And so if I look at it that way, then it's easier for me to be able to have good self-care. Because the office is full of amazing people, very educated, very driven, and I have to let people live in their life and be comfortable that they'll be okay. And if not, make it safe enough that you come to me and ask for help, and we go from there. But I have to be intentional about it every day. And I have to be able to know when to say no and when to be able to let go. And that's something I'm working on. And I'm okay with constructive criticism if it's not something I'm demonstrating.
Mark Pike, academic advisor. Okay, so you spoke a little bit about setting the bar for our students. And I'm just curious how you envision us balancing connecting students with the resources they need while also fostering a student who becomes self-sufficient. Because we know self-sufficient students create less pull on the advisor's time, so we're answering less emails like, hey, what's Ivy Tech's address, you know? And how do you strike that balance?
So I think I hear you saying is, how are we going to be able to support the students who are need more of our resources and need more of our time with the students who are self-sufficient and don't need that much from us, but still be able to give enough to them where they're supported?
Exactly.
Okay. All right. So with that, I think that, again, it goes back to also trusting the advisors. We have to be collaborative in our efforts because advising is a large department, and many people see us as so many people that can do everything, and that's not the truth. So the more we expose our colleagues to the work that we do, the more they'll realize that the support that they can give to us. And the more we see like cross-train and see what other departments are doing, which helps a lot with our joint meetings because we're starting to get more insight from one another. But there's departments that are already, like, we don't have to be everything in advising. Even though everyone says, see your advisor. Like, that is like a Jedi mind tricking. Like, that's not the truth. So you just have to be resourceful within yourself. And that's where the networks also come in, where we're connected to other departments. Because Ms. Gigi's department, they have a lot of things in place for those students who are more needy on certain things that our time just can't give. Or student success, have people who can coach and have a little longer time. We have to not take so much ownership in advising and not let the college take so much, put so much ownership on of these students' journey. It's not ours alone. We're not the only experts. We have a piece of the pie, but the whole pie is not ours to own. And so branding ourselves within our population to let everyone know what we stand for, the work that we do, what we value, I think will help, and then continue to collaborate and to work with each other to know where you need to pick up is this is where I'm stopping. And it's not because I don't care about the student, it's because I have to move on to something else because someone else needs me. Not that it's not my job, which I hate that saying, but it's just because I'm not in your lane. I'm gonna stay in my lane, and it's okay because we're all still in the race together. But we're not going to finish if we're all crashing into each other and wrecking. And that's what happens a lot of times. So we just need to be clear on what we stand for as advisors. And I think that that'll serve the students to its best.
Great answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah. So, Dr. Juan Jones, Executive Director at the Ivy Tech Lawrence Campus for Benjamin Harrison. Great presentation. My question to you, Ed, is, if you're offered this position, you step into the role of Director of Academic Advising, what is the one or two things that you wish that you would have received, maybe from the person who you report to, that you will take on, pass it along to the Academic Advising, your team?
I can't say enough access is something we all need to level up or manage up, as my mentor said. We're all good at certain things, we all have strengths, but to manage up is not to just work well within your strengths. And so to know where my team needs more additional support and giving them access to such is how you build engaged employees, but you also level people up. And that's what the goal of a lot of professionals are. We want to grow. And we want to know that we're valued. And I think that getting access to different information, different committees, just different opportunities, I think that that's what allows someone to be able to feel their worth and to feel valued. And that's something I didn't always have consistently. And it has to be consistent. And it can't be based off of your mood. You know, I have to take myself out of the equation and make sure that what my team has shared that they need is what I try to advocate and provide. And that access, it starts with access. I hope that answered your question.
Jenny, and then we'll go here, and then we'll go over here.
I'm Jenny Leonard. I'm the Director of Student Sponsor Retention and your guide for today. you said one thing that actually brought two questions related in time. So what are your future initiatives on staggering PEN distribution to students?
So at one point in time,
You know that, well, you might know, you might not know, that the communication plan to students included staggering PIN numbers based on cut hours.
Mm-hmm.
So that, and not necessarily staggering the PIN number, but that push. Just being an advisor because you need a PIN number.
Yes.
And it was done that way, and then of course, everybody still came at the same time. Not just you. Everywhere in the state. So if you can answer two questions for me, how would you in Indianapolis take the communication plan from systems office for this or anything else and then supplement that or work to supplement that with local communication? And then the second question, when things don't go as you plan them to go, how do you handle that?
Okay, so first one is, again, it has to go back to sharing that information or what's happening and what's talked about at the table. So the communication plan was very generalized that was given to us in our advising trainings that summer, and it was told to us in a way that made it seem like, even though it was staggered, that it meant that it was going to be staggered in the time that we had to work with it. And so it was a miscommunication automatically. So having an expectation that's not clear starts problems already. And advisors doing the work should have been more a part of those conversations and explained the process that was happening so we could have spoke to it and prepared better for it. And so we got that little tidbit and then it just happened, so it didn't feel like it was staggered to us. But just sending out a communication is the action behind it. So there wasn't enough time, it wasn't a great communication with the faculty who were very much a part of it, because when I told my faculty, they were like, okay, go ahead and do that. And then when I said, but your class is going to be filled, then mass hysteria, like what? You know, they lost their mind because it wasn't communicated to them. They could have been a part of the planning to prepare for that a little bit better. And I feel like when it comes to planning and preparing, those things are more proactive measures that we should have done with the PIN numbers and making sure advisors are at the table to have those discussions. Some things we're not going to be able to control because this is a large service area and things are harder to scale up. There's a difference. But I haven't sat at the table to have those conversations to know what the planning and the thought process was behind it, and many of my colleagues hadn't either. So we were just thrown into the mix and expected to perform at this level, and we didn't know the plan really. So I feel like I don't know how it's going to look, but once I sit at the table and had more discussions with people who have been doing this, I'm sure there's some better suggestions on how it can be staggered. And I definitely think when I say staggered, I mean staggered time so that people actually have those times to meet with those people. And if we're in the schools, just sending out communication will look different, because if we focus on like 50 and up, those are people getting ready to graduate, they matter. So making sure that they're taken care of in classes, I mean, who's to say that that deadline that opens September 16th, like those are things I don't know, who said that that had to be that day? Why can't we register with somebody sooner that's getting ready to graduate? Why do they have to wait for everybody else? That could be like, good job, if you ain't graduate, we're gonna go ahead and register you today for your last set of classes. But I don't know if that's already been tried or if it's not a good idea because I'm not at the table and I haven't been discussed what's been talked about at the table, and neither has the advising team. So I think things like that will help out a lot. Because there's some great ideas in the office and we don't know if they'll work because no one's asked. So there's that, and then when things don't work out, that happens a lot. So, and it's because it's so big here. It's a large department, it's a large service area, so things don't work a lot, actually. And people don't have to know that, but that's just because you have a strong team, and if you are communicating, I'm so big on communicating and being transparent, that everyone's getting paid, and I say it as jokes, but everyone's getting a check. You chose to be here, so you're gonna work while you're here. And what that work looks like, I don't know what it looks like because it depends on the day, but you're going to work. And so if the work is meaningful and you are happy to be here, you're not gonna mind to go ahead and kick in and, okay, this didn't work, we gotta jump in and change, you know, what the day looks like. Like it's first aerobic days, they never go the way that we plan or want them to go. But we managed to leave and everybody's still alive. So I mean, it's just, you have to let go and you have to be able to pick yourself up and come back to the table and come up with a plan. What's gonna happen next? But in the meantime and in between time, you must jump in and use your talents to change the narrative in that moment. And that's what I expect from every advisor. And pretty much they do that. So I have no complaints on them jumping in when things don't work out. I hope that answers your question. You've been a wonderful tour guide, too.
Hi, I'm Daniela Katz. I'm somehow old now. I'm not a big advisor, but we have a lot of new ones coming up. And thank you so much for the presentation. It's wonderful to hear about all your thoughts and all your changes that you're trying to, you know, hopefully be able to be successful in the advising office. One thing that I noticed when I came is a few things. One is that people think that they are working really well, and it's wonderful, but also a lot of things that I noticed, I'm shocked that things are not working, that people were either complacent or just complaining. But that it's not worth just saying anything because nothing is going to change. And actually that, to me, as a new academic advisor, was shocking. And so you, as the new director, what would you do to make people feel that they can go to you and even though some people might not be happy with that change, and tell you how we feel about that?
Well, there's always moles in the office, I want you to know, as a new person. So your business shall be told by someone. So there's that, it always will get back. So just know. There's no way that you really know. The department at large is like telephone. It'll get back, maybe not the way you want to, but it will get back. And so I always encourage people to share your own story. Because I like to speak for Shalamar because I know what I meant, what I said, and how I feel. But if someone else does it, then you know, it can get lost in translation. So I feel like I would encourage everyone to feel safe enough to speak their own story and share where their concerns are, because if you don't speak up, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. And that's just what I live by. I don't mind you saying anything to me, but if the way you're going to say it to me is what we're going to do it. And so come to me, share whatever, even if it's a complaint, but at the end of that complaint, it needs to be a period, but this is how what I was thinking to change. That's just what I've done with my team, and my mini team, it has worked. They're very opinionated people. And so they've always shared the ups and downs of things, and I've made it very comfortable for them to do so, but they also understand the expectation of, so then what? And so they'll fuss and cuss. They might leave and come back, but they come back and they come back with solutions. And because I'm an advocate, I'll take that to the table, or I'll take that to my leadership. And again, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. So just because you're disgruntled, I don't have to go tell Dr. Cowles or Dr. Lee, you know, that energy with it, but I can talk about the concern and the solution. And that's something that I welcome. And then onboarding, when it comes to being new and hearing all of that, onboarding needs to change and have a more supportive wraparound environment for you to come into, because we have not done well with that, and it's shown in many areas. And sometimes an employee that you might hear fussing and cussing is because they weren't really cared for, and the baton of negativity was passed to them, and they're passing it on. And so to take accountability for that happening means we have to do better with onboarding and have an expectation of having an attitude of gratitude. And that starts from my first slide, the highlight, is that employee engagement, you know, it has to be something we focus on. So that way you come into a culture that you feel like, this is why I interviewed, because this is why I want to be here. Not like, what did I do? Am I being punished? Because that's sometimes how people feel when they come in, is that they were tricked. And we don't want a brand new person feeling that way. So it's those two things, is making sure onboarding is better for you guys.
Thank you.
Introduce
yourself. Hi, I'm Marie Barron, Director of Admissions. So how do you get your entire team to work in a collaborative way with other departments?
being a servant leader, I lead by example. The standard I have for myself is the expectation I have for my mini team. And I think that when energy just permeates, whether it's good or bad. And so I'm intentional with making sure I have good energy. And when it's bad energy, it's clear on why it's bad. So there's no confusion. But then I also take action in making sure I'm engaging with other departments. We're sharing communication. We do things in collaborative effort. Because none of us, again, we shouldn't just own the student by ourselves. Each department has a working hand with one another. And as a new director, I'll be coming in as a new director as well. So we're going to have to make sure we go before one another as leaders. And then that's the example we have to show to our teams, is that if we work collaboratively together, then our teams will be held to that standard. And again, people getting paychecks helps out a lot to control things. So, I mean, people are here because they want to, not because they have to be. So while you're here, working is what we're here for. We can make it fun, but that's based off the energy that's brought. So just holding our teams accountable and showing as leaders that we can work together and we can come up with solutions. So that way they'll want to join what we're doing and be a part of it without pulling teeth. I hope that answered your question.
It did. Okay. It's a wonderful question.
Thank you, Ms. Martin. Ms. Shante?
Yes. I'm Shante from Advising. Wonderful presentation. Question. Because in Advising we've had a lot of changes and some changes are good, can you talk about what your commitment to, especially in the leadership piece, what your commitment is to
life? Well, I think I've demonstrated that by sticking with you guys. I've taken my show on the road. I have tried a couple times. I think I've demonstrated that I have a passion for the work we do. And more importantly, it's just in the professional world, academic advising is not something that we go to school for to become. And so there's some kind of disrespect that this is a professional career for us. And so that's why sometimes people jump ship, is because there is no pathway necessarily for academic advising. So people jump ship in different things because of the lack of development, the lack of support they have in being able to grow and develop. And so I feel like my commitment shows in the work I do, everything. I have a passion for what we do in advising. I think it's necessary, and I think it's a career. And most of the people who started working in the league, they go get great jobs because you become very marketable working in this particular area. So everyone has an opportunity to take their show on the road. But if someone leaves because they are becoming amazing because of the work they do here, that's a win. That's a win as a leader to me, and I take pride in that. But when people are leaving and they can't wait to go tell on you and write a long report like they're in class about you, that's a lose, regardless of where they go. If they stay with the college, that's not a good thing. And so I take pride in knowing that I want to create a culture that you can look at this as a career, you don't feel ran out, but if you leave, it's because you're running up, and that's okay with me. And so as long as there is a culture of engagement and people who want to be there, it makes me want to be there too.
Montrese Carlisle, Center of Affairs Coordinator. Recently, I've noticed that, I've been getting a lot of calls to set up appointments to do a little bit of cross training for my area to give out information. So have you thought about pulling in some of those key individuals from other departments to help with your assistance in that area so that they can be a little bit more knowledgeable, other than if someone says, they ask me to invite them, so I said, oh, call her, yeah, and then they're out of my hair, yeah, versus me trying to be a little bit more effective, or another person a little bit more effective to give them more information to kind of lighten the load of advising?
Volunteers are always awesome, but volunteers who are not prepared, you're not really being helpful as much as you would like to. So I definitely think that taking time in our joint meetings to cross-train. I definitely think in your downtime, making that selection to shadow or inviting someone to shadow you. Because the more we know about the work each other does, the more that we'll know where the gaps are that we need to fill in. I don't necessarily want just anyone advising, because I think my work is more important than that. And But I do think that we need help. So if people want the opportunity to learn some of the tools and skills that we need to help out in certain areas, I would always welcome volunteers. But not volunteers just thrown in because we're, you know, putting up an SOS. No, I would like to be proactive in that and making sure that maybe there's a consistent professional development that just goes that you get trained on certain things so that you're involved. Because there's many people around here who really want to help. They just don't know where they fit into the piece of the puzzle. So I feel like being proactive and not reactive in some of our efforts would help out. And then I definitely think the more people who are willing to be trained to learn some of the techniques that we have to do to take care of our students the way that we do, and vice versa with your department, I think that is amazing. And I think that's something that leadership should, and if I'm at the table, we'll talk about. Does that answer your question, Ms. Montrese? Anyone else want to fire at Nancy?
Deb. Everybody out. Shalamar, we all know, you know, from being an academic advisor, the office is expected to do so many things. How do you feel that you can set boundaries when higher administration is giving us one more thing on our plate? How will you handle that to protect your advisors?
Well, God, let me get a job first. I win them over first? Well, first, I had to win them over, so I had to cross our fingers, no. I'll be the new kid on the block, so I won't overpromise, so I can underdeliver. That's not my style. But you know me, and I do advocate, and I will speak to things that is shared, but there's just some things that we're just not going to like as a part of our job, unfortunately. But the way that I sell it and share it with you is what's going to help get the buy-in, and that's what my goal is. There are things that I definitely want us to take away, but to publicly say it now will set myself up, because then they will be like, oh, so that's what she thinks she's going to do. I'm not strategizing here, okay? But there are things that I think are definitely necessary to come off our plate, that I feel like it's meaningful work for maybe someone else, or it can create some type of other opportunity for someone. Even our work studies have done a lot that at one point in time we would have never allowed a student to do. So I think there's opportunities to create for other people, maybe not as much advisors, but again, I do all jokes aside, I do need to get a seat at the table. First, have a listening tour to listen to what's going on, what's already been done, what other departments.
Marlene.
One of my people.
Because I have been a lead advisor. I have been an advisor for a long time, but I haven't been a director of advisor.
Right.
So I have to come in understanding that and being a good steward and listening and seeing what they have to bring to the fold, because they're leaders for a reason, and I have to respect and understand that. But they're not advisors, and they haven't been in our shoes. So that's what my job is. And that'll probably come a little bit later, but definitely know there's going to be conversations about a better balance for us.
So as a director, we know the director of advising gets pulled out a lot to a lot of meetings. So how would you as a director maintain your presence in the office and transparency to the team?
Well, transparency is being honest and sharing where I am and what's going on and letting them know that, because sometimes when people are not present, you automatically think they're not working. I do, so I don't know about you. But I think that way sometimes. I'm like, they're having too good time and I ain't doing this work. And that's not always the truth. Because I've sat in meetings and I'd rather be in the office. So it's not always the truth that I'm doing something, that people who are not present are doing something that is so much more fun and less responsible. And so being clear and honest about where I am and what I have to do, and then trusting the lead. I always found great joy when the director wasn't present and they left it to us to do, because that was an opportunity for me to grow and for me to be exposed. And some of the reason why I'm sitting here today, because I had some of that access, because they weren't present. But then also being able to speak to my director, because when things are necessary for me to be present physically in the office, being able to have the confidence and courage to say that, that there's a lot going on, I haven't been around, and the team needs to see me. And anyone who doesn't understand that, I mean, that's going to be a whole different conversation. But I think that with the department this large, I think that it's understandable. And then sometimes the people downtown have to use those master's degrees and that problem solving and critical thinking and make it happen and work, because maybe I'm taking care of something at one of our other campuses for our advisors. And they also won't always be present. You know, I have to understand that as well, because we all are busy. We all have different things that we're a part of and serving on. So they're not always going to be present, but communication, setting aside time to continue having times of engagement, making sure I at least get twice a year, at least one-on-ones with people, to make that consistent, so I'm at least hearing a little bit myself of what's going on, to stay in tune. I think in fairness, being a leader doesn't mean you have to be present, but being clear on my communication and being purposeful in the work that I do, I think will demonstrate to the team when I'm not present that I'm still doing something that benefits all of us.
All right, we've time for one more question.
What are one of the misconceptions about the liaison department that when you're in the position you can change that narrative?
That we're incompetent and we do everything wrong. We get blamed for everything, and if everybody keeps sending everybody to us. It's like, if you're not good, why do you keep sending them to us? But that's something that I think that just our presence, being able to be in the schools more, because a lot of times it's the faculty who feel a certain way, because a lot of their metrics are tied to the work that we do on the student affairs side, and they just don't sometimes get it and understand. So the more that we are over there in the schools with them, that would help. And then something like you created, the joint meetings. The joint meetings help us to share and talk about things, because even in those meetings, we started to point fingers in a family type way, and we're able to correct it immediately so things don't manifest. So I think the more that we continue, I can't say collaboration enough. Like, we cannot be in silos for any purpose and for any reason. No one's job is greater than the other, and no one can do their job by themselves, even with the team that they have. So I think that the more that we join together and join forces to not only meet our own metrics and goals in departments, but for the college, I think that a lot of different things will change, and that has to be a collaborative effort, not just for me to come in to do, Marnie, yourself, Dr. Handy. That is a responsibility for all of us. And as long as you want to work here, I think that you, that is the expectation that we should bring anybody in to work in Ivy Tech, is that this is a collaborative community, and if you can't collaborate regardless of what competencies you have or don't have, maybe this is not the place for you, and I think that's okay. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you.
I think what?